Right. Well, let's go ahead and get started. Welcome, everybody, and happy Human Rights Day. On this day, marking the anniversary of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, we have much to celebrate. The advocates and our volunteers work every day to end violence against women and girls. We document survivors' experiences in the justice system through our local watch project. We empower partners around the world with technical assistance. We strengthen laws that protect women and girls. And of course, we have just launched our newest report on the backlash to human rights and the Istanbul Convention. You can support these efforts by making a donation. Simply text WOMEN'S to 44321 or click on the link in the chat to donate. We'll now be turning to hear our conversation with our partners in Turkey, AŞİK Women's Platform for Equality. Because of the time difference, I had a chance to jump on a Zoom call with them the other day to hear how their work is going and what the situation is like for women in Turkey. So let's go ahead and go to that video now.
It is an honor to introduce our partners, AŞİK Women's Platform for Equality. AŞİK, which means threshold, was created by more than 300 groups to fight against attacks on our vested rights, such as amnesty for child abusers and Turkey's withdrawal from the Istanbul Convention. As we are going to hear from them in a moment, the members of AŞİK in Turkey are working under difficult conditions, shrinking space for NGOs, and rollbacks to laws that protect women's human rights. But in the midst of these very difficult circumstances, AŞİK is nevertheless undertaking crucial, life-saving work for women and girls in Turkey. So I'd like to begin and turn to our esteemed panelists. We're so delighted to have you join us today. Thank you, especially on this day marking December 10th, Human Rights Day. I'd like to begin by asking if you could please introduce yourselves and tell us briefly about AŞİK and its work.
I shall start from the first question. My name is Özgül, and I'm trying to support platform work as one of the communicators, one of the organizational worker of the activities throughout the work groups. It is composed not only for defending Istanbul Convention, but also a whole, I mean, there is a whole attack toward women's rights in Turkey. And it's not new, actually. It's, let's say, since 2015, we are living a very obvious and an open, open to public attacks against our rights and our gained rights. And by saying gained, we mean a very realistic situation, because we really gained these rights, and we fighted to write the legal framework and the implementation of this framework as the whole women's organizations, feminist organizations of Turkey. So it's an overall purpose to defend against these attacks, fundamentalist attacks, and stop them, and then reclaim it, maybe redefine in favor of the improving gender equality in general. We say generally 300 organizations are involved in this platform, but I shall say more than 1,000 women and LGBTI plus people are joining the platform activities. It's meeting every Wednesday, and all the decisions are being discussed in these weekly meetings over online networks. And there is working groups in top thematic fields. For instance, There's a legal rights work group, health, women's health work group, blah, blah, an international relations work group. There's almost 15 work groups and a coordination work group, which is trying to coordinate the meetings and the different actions taken by in the work groups. That's all for now about ASIC. If you have any specific question, I can go further.
Thank you, Oskol. That's a great profile of ASIC and its organization. And I know you swiftly came together as a group to counter this backlash and to work on human rights. And it sounds like you really hit the ground running. I do have a follow-up question to ASIC's work and structure. I understand that ASIC is volunteer-based and it has not formally registered as an NGO. I was wondering if you can tell us more about why you chose to form ASIC in this way.
Okay, now let me just translate it a little bit. Berin'cim, ikinci soruya geçtik. Önce istersen tabii ki de kendini tanıtırsın. Daha sonra da işin gönüllü olduğunu biliyoruz ama bir NGO olarak kayıtlı bir kurum değil. Bu anlamda çalışmalarınızı nasıl ilerletiyorsunuz diye soruyor ve de daha biliyorsun herhalde tahmin ediyorum anti-corruption law diyor ama olağanüstü halden sonra derneklere yönelik herhalde kapatmalardan bahsediyor kendisi. Bu anlamda da bir şey eklemek ister misin diye soruyor.
Aslında bu birinci sorunun devamıydı ama Berin cevaplasın. Olur, güzel olur.
Tamam, olur. Tabii bu arada herhalde ikinci soru bir de kadının insan hakları Türkiye'de durumu neydi şeklindeydi. Ona da devam ederiz o zaman, öyle mi?
Evet, sıradan okuyoruz. İkiyi okuyordu şimdi herhalde üçe de geçecek.
Tamam. Peki, selamlar öncelikle Roz. Bizi kabul ettiğin için teşekkürler. Bu bizim görüşlerimizi önemsediğin için daha doğrusu teşekkür ediyorum. Arkadaşlarla birlikte bilmiyorum ne kadar etkili olabileceksek. Ben şöyle cevaplandırmak istiyorum öncelikle NGO sorusunu. Şöyle cevaplandırmak istiyorum. Bekleyeyim mi?
Öncelikle Rose, Berin states that we are so grateful for you to organize this discussion, and this states that you are, as an organization, care about things that going on in Turkey, and she wants to continue. Evet, Berin.
Evet, Türkiye'de olağanüstü halden itibaren sivil toplum örgütlerinin üzerindeki baskılar arttı. Yalnız olağanüstü halden önce de hiçbir zaman çok iyi durumda olmadı sivil toplumun özgür çalışma şartları, demokrasi sorunlarımızla örtüşen bir şekilde hiçbir zaman özgür çalışamadı sivil toplum. Ancak giderek kötüleştiğini söylemek lazım. Sivil toplum...
Elimcim dur istersen.
As you know, after military coup in Turkey, there are some laws that... Olağanüstü hali çeviremedim arkadaşlar ama nasıl söyleyebiliriz?
Kind of military occupation.
Yeah. Yes, there were strict laws after military coup, but even it didn't start at that time. Before, it was hard in Turkey as an NGO, in terms of democracy and in terms of freedom of speech and freedom of advocacy.
Evet, ve bazı dernekler kanununda değişiklikler yapıldı. Yapısal değişiklikler dolayısıyla pek çok insan sivil toplum alanında aktif olduğu zaman hükümet birimleri tarafından fişlenmekte olduğunu gördü yapılan yasal değişiklikle. Fişlenmemek için pek çok örgüt ya kendisini kapattı ya da insanlar o örgütlerden ayrılıp sessizliğe gömüldüler. Burada bir
with some laws passed about associations and civil society, government started to synchronize activists and try you know to label activists that are, advocating. So this made civil society a little bit reluctant about advocacy. So some organizations chose to close themselves, or some activists started to be more, you know, reluctant and seek other ways of doing this, not to be registered, but maybe other ways of doing advocacy.
Evet, benim çalışmakta olduğum Başkent Kadın Platformu da, Capitalist Women Platform diyoruz Elif'ciğim. Aynı şekilde tüzel kişiliğine son vermek zorunda kaldı bu yıllarda. Hem maddi sorunlar, çünkü devletin sivil toplum kuruluşlarına yüklediği maddi sorumluluk da çok fazla. Bunu karşılamak da kadın örgütleri için özellikle zor. Dolayısıyla tüzel kişiliğimize son verdiğimizde ülkede tüzel kişilik olmadan da sivil toplum faaliyetleri ve aktivizm yapmak yönündeki zaten gelişmekte olan eğilimler hız kazandı. Artık daha önemli hale geldi.
As an example, the platform of Başkent Kadın Platformu. Berincim, ne dedin İngilizcesine?
Capitalist Women Platform.
Capitalist Women Platform, which Berin was a member of, chose to close its, you know, institutional institution as a way of doing other way of advocacy because of also government some sanctions and financial difficulties. As you know, in Turkey recently, government, we call them Gongo, the civil societies that are founded by the hand of government also has had more space in Turkey financially and otherwise. So then especially women's organization realized that there are other ways of advocacy. We can be more free without registering like platforms and networks.
Can I have a contribution at this moment? Actually, Turkey's women organizations has the capacity and has the ability of coming together to form campaigning groups on specific issues. All the structural revolutionary steps was taken with their efforts, with their combined efforts, especially since the beginning of 20s, let's say, but it's more than this, of course, more roots than these dates, but specific achievements taken by a common work and common activity on civil law and also the penal law, some revolutionary actions was taken altogether, and Eşik has placed its presence on this culture, on this cumulative culture, actually. But we have the great opportunity of meeting every day, almost every day. Through the, I mean, pandemic is still bad for all of us, but it's gave such a great opportunity.
Well, that's wonderful. Thank you for sharing that history of Eşik and why you strategically chosen to work in the way you do, especially given the government restrictions, the face of those gongos, those government-operated NGOs, as well as the historical context. And I know that there's some anti-corruption laws as well that would place undue restrictions and possibly place your board members at risk of being removed by the government if they chose to make that. So it sounds like you chose a very wise strategy to continue your work in the most free way possible. You know, that might be a good segue from your work that you do at Eşik to the situation of women in Turkey. I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit about the situation of women's human rights in your country.
Berincim, kadının insan hakları ile ilgili Türkiye'deki mevcut durumu biraz özetleyebilir miyiz?
Evet. Kadının insan hakları konusunda Türkiye'de Aslında önemli kazanımlarımız çok uzun yıllardır devam eden güçlü bir kadın hareketiyle birlikte elde edildi. Bu önemli kazanımların gerçekten eşitlik yönünde tam fiili eşitliğe dönmediğini biliyoruz. Ancak bu yönde çabalar sürdürülüyor. İktidar şu anda kadınların kazanımlarını gasp etmek, geri almak üzerine çalışıyor. Yani aynı AKP iktidarının ilk yıllarında büyük ihtimalle konjonktürel gerekçelere dayanarak pek çok iyileştirme yapmıştı ama sonra bu iyileştirmeleri birer birer geri almaya başladı. Özellikle son 3 yılda çok hızlandı bu durum. Türkiye'de şu anda kadının insan hakları konusunda biz kadınlar iktidarla savaşmak zorundayız ve bunu yapmaya çalışıyoruz eşik platformda. Tamam?
As you know, there's a very strong women's movement in Turkey throughout the years who had gained women's rights in Turkey. And when AKP government first came in 2002, with the effect of, you know, membership to EU and other conjunctional things, they acted like as if they were in favor of women's rights. But now we see that it's not like that. Especially since it started with 2010. You know, at that time President Erdogan said that he doesn't believe in equality, and by throughout the years, but especially last 3 years, really there is an attempt to, you know, take our rights back from us. This is so women's organizations and women's movements in Turkey right now is heavily attached to our rights, and we are just struggling to this huge attempt from the government.
Biraz daha eklemek istiyorum ama şöyle bir şey de var. Biz her an her şeye hazırlıklı olmak zorunda hissediyoruz kendimizi. İktidar her an bir gece yarısı yeni bir hakkımızı elimizden alabilir diye sürekli meclisi izliyoruz. Sürekli resmi gazeteden çıkacak kararları bekliyoruz. Her an gözümüz Türkiye'deki bütün sivil toplum ama özellikle de kadın hareketi yapılacak saldırılara karşı hazırlıklı olmak için öngörülerde bulunmak ve bu öngörüler doğrultusunda stratejiler geliştirmek zorunda hissediyoruz kendimizi ve bunu da yapmaya çalışıyoruz. Önümüzde pek çok ihtimal var. Önce şuna mı saldırırlar, işte önce buna mı, sonra buna mı saldırırlar? Bunların hepsine adım adım hazırlık yapmak zorunda hissediyoruz kendimizi ve bunu gerçekleştiriyoruz. Şu anda benim öngörüm medeni kanuna doğru bir saldırı olabileceği. Medeni kanunla elde ettiğimiz bazı hakların, aile hukukuna ilişkin hakların dini hükümlerle değiştirilme ihtimali olduğunu düşünüyorum ve endişeleniyorum bu konuda.
Rose, especially we are what Beren strongly states that we are alarmed, we are alerted. You know, since especially like in last 2 years, we are gathering together in every moment because we know that at one time, at one night, our government can withdraw like it did from Istanbul Convention. So we are ready, like in a you know, really. Alerted and alarmed, we get together, we try to perceive what is going to come next, and we try to strategize. We lived it very clearly in Istanbul Convention, for example. We knew that there was an attack coming. We knew that also from the world. Also, we are monitoring the world and we are seeing what's happening in the world as well. And it happened like we perceived. One day it started with some statement, and then at one night with a decree, they get rid of Istanbul Convention. So Beren also states that we are expecting new attempts, like an attempt to civil law might happen, an attempt to family law under religious, you know, religious, how can I framework there might be some attempts. So we are ready, you know, we are alarmed. And Turkish women's movement is really one of the maybe the most strongest now opposition movement in Turkey in every terms.
And Beren, I think that what you did was really capture the kind of situation that the far right anti-gender movement poses to women's rights, that they are out there and they're making real changes that harm women and girls. And so therefore the women's rights movement has to be on edge, has to be poised at every moment and prepared for whatever could come down, whether it is a withdrawal from a seminal treaty like Istanbul Convention, or changes to civil and family laws, like you mentioned. And thank heavens for a group like Eshik that can stay there and be poised and at the forefront of all of this happening. Aşkul, I'm going to give
Let me just translate it to Berin. Bize katılıyor. Yani bu son olanlarda ne kadar çok alarmda olduğumuzu ve de önümüze gelebilecek yeni attemptlere kadar attemptlere karşın Türkiye Kadın Hareketi'nin ne kadar alarmda ve güçlü olduğundan bahsediyor.
Let me add one point. We thank to President Erdogan as well. for the reason that he canceled the Istanbul Convention, because while we are defending Istanbul Convention, our followers who were once away from feminist movement generally, they are now supporting. I mean, we enlarged our supporters in terms of the gender equality. That's why thank to him as well.
I think that's the silver lining we can draw from this. This backlash is so alarming and such a rollback to human rights that people are coming to the forefront, new supporters, new people who want to be a part of our cause and keep on protecting women's rights. Well, let me move on, because since we're talking about Turkey's withdrawal, the grave news that we saw this summer was Turkey's withdrawal from the Istanbul Convention. Now, in the Advocates for Human Rights report called A Rollback to Human Rights, the Istanbul Convention Under Attack, we detail the far rights movement to undermine human rights and with it, the Istanbul Convention. Now, for those of you in the audience who are unfamiliar with this, the Istanbul Convention is the most comprehensive treaty on violence against women. It is an important tool for women's rights activists around the world to hold their governments accountable to protect women's rights if their government chooses to ratify it. Now, despite initial momentum, the Istanbul Convention now faces growing opposition across Europe, Central Asia, and in Turkey from an anti-gender movement that not only opposes women's rights, but also opposes LGBTI rights, immigration, gender education, and basic sexual and reproductive rights. So that means the Istanbul Convention, and with it, the right of women to be free from violence, has become collateral damage in a broader transnational movement that opposes many of the rights it associates, correctly or not, with the treaty. And increasingly, we are also seeing women's human rights defenders facing threats to their physical safety. Many of the advocates' partners, for example, they have reported incidents of violence and attacks, and the space for civil society is shrinking in the face of these far-right groups. But nevertheless, in the face of these coordinated attacks, we know that civil society plays an increasingly crucial role in defending women's rights to be free from violence. So despite the rising challenges, human rights NGOs have mounted successful campaigns engaging thousands of women in support of the Istanbul Convention and women's rights. And it's groups like AISHIC that keep women's rights alive and at the forefront of public discussion and policy. So I actually want to turn back to our partners here and ask all of you, what does Turkey's withdrawal from the Istanbul Convention mean for women's rights?
Berin, İstanbul Sözleşmesi'nin iptalinin kadın haklarına yansıması nasıl oldu diyor. Hani ne tür kayıplar. Onun öncesinde çeşitli kampanyaları anlattı. Öncesinin çevresine çok gerek yok. İstersen sen başla, ben de eklerim.
Tamam can. İstanbul Sözleşmesi'nin Türkiye'de öncelikle hukuksuz bir şekilde, iç hukuka aykırı bir şekilde feshedildiğini belirtelim. Bu Türkiye'nin kendi hukuk devleti olma kriterini aşındıran bir karar oldu her şeyden önce. Kadın haklarının son derece ciddi bir gerilemeye götürmek için yol açıldığını düşünüyorum.
Rose, as you know, firstly, what Berin mentions is very important, that we do not accept, we accept that this withdrawal is not according to law. It's, as you know, our constitution 90, item 90 says that if a law contradicts with an international treaty, the international treaty is valid. So the withdrawal from the convention with a decree by law is not possible. This is what the constitution professor says, and we ESHIK also advocate for this. So this is totally, of course, diminishes the rule of law. It's a backlash for a women's movement, women's human rights.
Evet, Türkiye'de birçok diğer İstanbul Sözleşmesi'ni tartışan ülkede olduğu gibi Polonya, Hırvatistan, Macaristan falan, işte bu ülkelerde olduğu gibi Türkiye'de de dindar kesimin İstanbul Sözleşmesi'ne son derece karşı olduğunu biliyoruz. Yani eşitlik karşıtlığını dindarlık zanneden gruplar var. Ben de inançlı bir insanım ve ben inanıyorum ki Allah'ın dini onların söylediğini söylemiyor. O ruhbanların dini, hem Katoliklerde hem Protestanlarda hem Ortodokslarda hem Müslümanlarda ruhbanlar Allah'ın dinini kendilerinin otoriteleri için değiştiriyorlar. Ben böyle inanıyorum. Dolayısıyla toplumsal cinsiyet eşitliğinin dinlere aykırı olmadığını, insana yaraşır olanı dine aykırı olamayacağına inanıyorum. Ama işte Türkiye'de İstanbul Sözleşmesi'nden geri çekilme kararı bu katı ruhban sınıfa, din otoritelerine büyük bir paye verdi. O din otoritelerini destekleyen bir karar olduğunda Türkiye'deki bütün kadın hakları ve Türkiye'deki bütün kadınların güvenlikleri tehdit edilmiş oldu. Bence çok güçlendirdi çünkü iktidar o tarafı. O tarafı güçlendirdiği zaman kadınların kendilerini savunması daha güçleşiyor. Aslında mevcut şiddetin daha çok arttığını gösteren emareler var. Fakat elimizde veriler yok. Ama önemli olan veriler olarak artması da değil de daha çok politika olarak kadınların güçlendirilmesinden, eşitliğinden, LGBT'yi artılı bireylerin güçlendirilmesinden ve eşit sayılmasından vazgeçildiğinin açık bir ilanı oldu bu karar. Bunun için da kesinlikle kadın haklarına aykırı.
I would like to summarize it. It's like, Rose, it's like in other European countries, like in Poland. These attempts comes from the far right movements, but in Turkey it's under religion, but not, it's a very, you know, we don't talk about the beliefs, you know, we talk about the very far religious groups. And Berin underlines that gender equality doesn't contradict with religion. It's nothing to do about, you know, it's not religion. So it's politically in Turkey, this attempt from the withdrawal from the Istanbul Convention is like a cake given to those far religious groups. And it's a political attempt. We see it in that way. It's a political attempt. But of course, it undermines that, as you said, from the convention, it's not just about women's rights. It's about LGBTs. It's about refugees. Istanbul Convention has a lot of items that has a whole, you know, conceptual approach to the violence against women. And Berin underlines it that she is also a religious person, but she is an advocate of gender equality. And it's not about those priesthood groups who tries to manipulate government, and government reflects to those groups while withdrawing from Istanbul Convention.
And I shall say those groups are not the majority of the society. We can call them minority groups. It's not millions of people. It's just some groups who came together in this specific fundamentalist targets. The most important result of this cancellation is this encouraged those groups to claim more than this, and it showed to the society that the convention is cancelled, so anything can be cancelled with these kind of attacks. I mean, we may woke up in a morning that our civil law was cancelled, and we won't be surprised if that happens. Which you know it was signed 100 years ago while the Turkish Republic is being established, and then revised in favor of gender equality by the great efforts of women's organizations. That is the biggest impact of the cancellation of the convention.
Özgül, I think you've hit the nail on the head, and it is that this announcement that has not followed the legal process in Turkey, and we stand in solidarity with you as you challenge the legality of this, but it sets a most dangerous precedent. If they can withdraw from this really important treaty on women's rights, what's next? And Berin is exactly right in saying that we need to also look at the political field. We have a number of different actors that we describe in our report on the Istanbul Convention. The actors are at times religious bodies, sometimes individual actors, sometimes secularized NGOs or even gangos. But underpinning all of this is that the action and our campaigning must take place at the political field, because that is where the policy takes place. So we really need to gain entry in there and keep on pushing for women's rights there. You know, hearing you talk and thinking about the multitude challenges that you face makes me want to ask all of you as volunteers and human rights defenders, what is the situation like for you as activists working right now in Turkey?
Berin?
Ah canım.
Elif sen de cevap verebilirsin. Biz seni...
Yok ya, senden başlarız diye düşündüm.
Evet, ben tercüme bekliyorum onun için.
Berin, insan hakları savunucularının için hayat şu an Türkiye'de nasıl? Yani böyle bir mücadele veriyorsunuz ama insan hakları savunucularının durumu nedir? Nelerle karşı karşıyasınız diye soruyorum.
Evet, internetim yavaşladı. Özgür'ün söylediklerinin büyük kısmını duyamadım. Onun için görüntümü kapattım. İstersen onu da bir söyle.
Berin post down her video because the internet slowed down, so just apologies for that.
Evet, hayat nasıl? Aslında son günlerde tam da 10 Aralık İnsan Hakları Günü'ne gelirken beni en çok rahatsız eden şeylerden birisi de hükümetin yaptıklarının dışında bir de insan hakları savunucularının ve genel olarak muhalif siyasetçilerin, kitlesel muhalefetin hepsinin birden kadın haklarını hep alt başlıkları iter olması. Yani insan hakları savunucularına karşı bile biz kadınlar kadının insan hakları konusunu savunmak zorunda kalabiliyoruz. Son zamanlarda Olympe de Gouges'dan bu yana çok fazla şeyin değişmediğini düşünür oldum Türkiye'de. Böyle de bir durum var ama evet, hükümetin yaptığı saldırılar hepsinin üstünde. Fakat patriarkal düşünceyi hala ülkenin belli başlı insan hakları savunucusu örgütlerinin bile içinde hissedebiliyorum. Türkiye'de kadının insan hakları açısından durum böyle. İktidarın tüm olarak insan haklarına yönelik yok sayma, hak ihlalleri ve hak ihlali yapanları cezalandırmama eğilimleri korkunç boyutta tabii ki.
Yes, for as of human rights advocacy, of course, Turkey is passing through tough times. That's for sure. But what Beren wants to open a parenthesis is that it's even harder for us as a women's human rights advocates, because in the beginning of the conversation, Beren told, but I forgot to translate that, we have a lot of laws in terms of gender equality under the law. We don't have much problem, but as a society thinking and as the patriarchal, of course, structure, we have many difficulties. And even in the human rights, even we have difficulties to defend women's human rights against human rights advocates. You know, government perceive women's human rights advocates as the minorist group, you know. Even in this patriarchal society, it's much more harder for us to be a women's human rights advocate. Özgür bir şey eklemek ister misin?
Yes. For us, let me say, first of all, we have to work more than 24 hours. That's one of the results, actually. We have to always read and watch what's going on and try to keep together in the groups and try to push the strategic points. It's not always easy, even in Eşik platform. We are trying to push the key strategic points. We have been narrowed into our homes. The streets is forbidden because of pandemic, but before that, we were forbidden some women demonstrations was attacked by the police, and some hard attacks is being made in the west of country. In east of countries, something else, some other. How can I describe it? It's another level, you know. Women activist is being watched, is being followed step by step. I was one of the cities that in the region in east of Turkey. I was invited for a speech in relation with international women's combating women's violence against women day. I have seen by eye, street by street, hour by hour, we have been followed by the police cars and police, civil police. We are all thinking that everything can happen very soon, this week or tomorrow or next. We don't know when and what level the oppression will come. At the moment, women's activities, women's rights activities is being approved by the majority of the society. Let me give another figure. 68% of Turkish population general approves Istanbul Convention and do not like the cancellation. And women's organization is being approved almost 80% of of the society is approving women's organizations' activities, especially in terms of the struggle against violence against women and femicide. This is an important point because we are the half of the population, and we have all a vote. But we are not sure if there will be a democratic election anymore. So we don't feel safe anymore, completely.
I am just listening to you, and I'm just imagining the wave of challenges that you must face at any given moment, hour, or any given day. On top of being marginalized as women's rights movement, you as activists, as individual human rights defenders, you face monitoring and harassment and this omnipresent wondering and fear of what's going to happen next, because anything is possible that could happen to the activists. I can't even imagine, there's so much courage that it takes to do the work that you do. So I just want to thank you for that again. And just know that we're standing in solidarity with you here across the ocean, as sisters here in the women's rights movement. You know, and speaking of solidarity, our partnership with you at AISHC, it's newer. I think we probably met in about the last year, but that does not mean it's any less valuable for that reason. And I was wondering if you could briefly mention, how has your collaboration with us at the Advocates for Human Rights had an impact or affected your work that you do in Turkey?
Elif, yanıtlamak ister misin?
Özlem burada belki girmek ister misin?
Ha, Özlem girse daha güzel olur. Evet.
Özlem burada değil. Berin'cim, şeyden bahsediyor Rose, bu Advocate for Human Rights'da olan işbirliğimiz geçen sene başladı. Yani yeni bir işbirliği olsa da her zaman yanındayız. Bu tip dayanışmaların sizin işinizi nasıl etkiledi diye soruyor. Belki Afganistan toplantımızdan ve yurt dışı toplantılardan bahsedebiliriz. Bilemiyorum ben, hani işte aklıma gelenler o.
Tabii ki. Teşekkürler. Evet, yani şu anda biz AISHC platform olarak yurt dışında kurduğumuz bu bağlantıların, ağların, ilişkilenme biçimlerinin iktidar tarafından olumsuzlandığına dair bir şey görmedik. Ben onu hissetmedim. Şu anda bizi dikkate almıyor gibi görünüyorlar bu uluslararası farklı örgütlerle ilişkilerimizi. Devam edeceğim, burada durayım mı?
Tamam. Rose, what Berin says, and I would like to also add that starting from AISHC's collaboration with you and the other actors in the international arena, because as Özgür mentioned before, with the opportunity or with the circumstances, not circumstances that COVID-19 put us through, we took this opportunity and had a lot of solidarity meetings with, like you, we did with our sisters in Afghanistan. We did many meetings with European Union partners. So this is really, this was really the circumstances turned out to an opportunity of solidarity for AISHC. And but also what Berin mentions is very important, that somehow now the government or the other actors doesn't seem to be bothered by this solidarity, doesn't seem to see this, you know. We do a lot of campaigns with related to your the previous question. Of course, it is hard to be a human rights advocate, but we are a group of very legitimate way of doing advocacy. You know, we do campaigns, we try to raise awareness, we try to do lobby activities with opposition parties in every opposition group, and with the solidarity that you have shown to us and the other sisters all around the world, of course, as the enormous value to our job, really.
Evet, ben şimdi biraz daha söylemek istiyorum, çok uzatmadan. Belki de hükümetin buna sessiz kalışı bizim uluslararası tüm örgütlerle yaptığımız çalışmaların güçlendirici etkisidir. Kendisini biraz beklemek zorunda hissetmiş olması ihtimali de benim için iyimser bir yorum olarak beni iyi hissettiriyor. Böyle bir iyimser yorumum da var yani. Fakat Eşik Platform Türkiye'de geçmiş kadın örgütlerinin örgütlenme biçimlerinin hepsinden yararlandığı gibi özgün taraflara da sahip. Buna da gireyim. Çok kısa bir şekilde ona da değinmek istiyorum. Bu soruyla bağlantılı olarak sen çevir.
Again, Berin says that she is a little bit optimistic about the silence from the government that Eşik has shown solidarity with international parties. Maybe it's a wait and see strategy by the government. So they seem that they don't see us. So we didn't have any attacks from any party upon our solidarity with international organizations. So maybe it's a wait and see strategy, she says. And also she wants to mention a little bit more about the different ways that Eşik organized and came together.
Eşik kendi içinde de bir takım koalisyonlara benzeyen bir yapıya sahip. Şimdiye kadar konu bazlı kadın örgütlenmeleri ve platformları ile çalışmıştık biz kadın hareketi deneyiminde. İlk defa Eşik'te tüm konuları içeren her türlü kadın sorunu ve politikaları üreten, her alanda politika üreten bir yapıya dönüşmek ihtiyacı duymuştuk. Özgül bahsetmişti bundan. İşte bu doğrultuda biz Türkiye'de daha önce kadın örgütlenmelerinde yapılmadığı şekilde karma örgütlerden, kurumlardan, sendikalardan vesaire de destekçilere sahip olduk. Bu Türkiye için yeni bir deneyimdi, Türkiye Kadın Hareketi için. Böyle bir deneyim, bir koalisyona ulaşmak, bir koalisyonun yolunu açmak gibi tüm dünya feministlerinin üzerine düşündüğü bir meselede eşiğin de yol aldığı, almakta olduğu anlamına geliyor. Bunu da yani ne kadar bağlantılıydı soruyla kaçırdım ama bunu da belirtmek istedim.
Önemli bir nokta, iyi yaptın.
Bence de. Berin specifically mentions the new way of working under Eşik platform. You know, there were before in Turkish Women's Movement, women's organizations were gathering together around different teams of under different headings and in advocacy. But in under Eşik, we have supporters from occupational organizations, supporters from not only women's organizations, but like, bar associations, other health organizations. So it's the way the feminists started thinking, have been thinking, in such a amount of time that we have to go this way together to open way of new coalitions for advocacy. So I think this was an important point as well to point out. So thank you, Berin, for pointing that.
Absolutely. Thank you, Berin. And you actually echo one of our report's recommendations, which is to go out there and find the unconventional allies. Bridge over to other movements because we're going to grow in solidarity and numbers and volume. So thank you for bringing up that important point. Well, as we come to the conclusion of our talk today, I do want to pose one last question for you. What is the one takeaway that you want people in the United States to know about the situation in Turkey?
Evet, Özgü, senden başlayalım.
Tamam. I wonder American community can imagine a country who is the strategic partner of the United States, that there is no constitutional law and laws are not being implemented, and there is no parliamentary participation and no democracy. How they can call Turkey as a strategic partner? If their strategic partner is a country like that, so what is next? I want to ask this question to American population.
Berin'cim, son olarak Amerika'daki insanların Türkiye'deki durumla ilgili neyi bilmesini istersiniz diye sorarlar.
Ben şöyle bir cevap verdim.
Ne istersiniz diyor.
Berin'cim, yani Amerikan kamuoyuna şunu sormak isterim. İşte Türkiye için stratejik ortak deniyor. İşte anayasaya uyulmayan hiçbir demokrasi olmayan bir ülkeye strateji ortak diyorlarsa neye demiyorlar?
Teşekkürler. Tamam. Evet, şimdi bu konuda ben tam Özgür'le aynı düşünmüyorum. Çünkü ben Amerika'nın politikalarının, Amerikan hükümetlerinin politikalarının daima demokrasiden yana olduğuna inanan bir insan değilim. Kendi askeri ve ekonomik çıkarları doğrultusunda bazen demokrasiyi desteklerken bazen antidemokratik ülkeleri son derece desteklediğini biliyoruz. Bu uluslararası siyasetin doğası. Öyle bir şey beklemiyorum ben Amerika'dan. Ama Amerika'daki sivil toplum örgütlerinin, Amerikan halkının Türkiye hakkında düşünmesini istediğim şeylerin başında şu geliyor. Türkiye halkı 100 yıldır demokrasi yönünde mücadele eden bir halk. Demokrasi yönünde ilerlerken pek çok zaman kesintiye uğrasak da daima biz demokrasiye doğru yol alıyoruz. Buna dair ümidim hala çok yüksek. Bunu bilmesini isterim Amerikan sivil toplum örgütlerinin ve halkının. Amerikan hükümeti beni ilgilendirmiyor.
After Özgür's remarks, Berin says that specifically and individually, she thinks that she doesn't think that all, of course, U.S. politics is democratic. U.S. government's politics is sometimes in hand with economic strategies and military strategies. But in terms of public, in terms of U.S. people, she would like to know that Turkish people in Turkey has a journey towards democracy. Always in hundreds of years, people in Turkey is fond of democracy, would like to live in a democratic country, and will not give up and trying our way towards democracy. And I would like to add that of course patriarchy is universal, and we are facing many things similar as in Turkey and in other countries. But also I want to add up and wrap it up with hope, and we won't give up from our rights. Eşik, the advocates in Eşik, in other women's organizations in Turkey, we will be watching our government, and also maybe also internationally we are watching other countries as well. So we are not going to give up from our rights.
Those are powerful words to end our presentation today on Human Rights Day. Thank you all of you, Elif, Özgür, Berin, and Özlem, for being here today with us. And thank you for the incredible, courageous work you are doing to save women's lives. We are thinking of you, and we remain in solidarity with you and the women in Turkey. Thank you, and have a great day. Happy Human Rights Day.
Well, that's a wonderful way to draw inspiration on this day, this Human Rights Day. And we're just so proud to be able to partner and honored to partner with Eşik. Peggy and I would like to open it up for any questions or comments that you might have with regard to our work or our conversation with Eşik or the situation in Turkey. We're waiting for those questions to come in. Peggy, is there anything you want to add? I know you did so much work on Turkey, writing that briefing paper and examining the issue of the Istanbul Convention. Anything you want to add?
One of the things that I think is really interesting about Turkey and the anti-gender movement and the backlash to the Istanbul Convention there is that it really demonstrates that the arguments, and you put many of them in the chat room that they advance there, which are the same ones that you have in Europe, have a universality about them, whether they're advanced in a very Christian context, which is what happens in Central and Eastern Europe, or happens in a Muslim context, which occurs in Turkey. And it's all motivated by this patriarchal view of where women should be in society.
Thanks, Peggy. And I think thank you for the commentary on the situation of Turkey and the women there. I believe we had a hand raised. I want to see, Elena, did you have a question?
Yes, hello. Hello to everyone. Actually, my question is about the political system in Turkey, especially political parties. And my question is, because I'm really not following so closely the present political life in Turkey, but are all political parties are so consolidated around the mainstream to be against women's rights? And is there any, how to say, any light on in the tunnel? Is there any liberal movement, if it is possible? This is my question, because in my country we have such kind of a transformation, but you know, we are after third general elections this year, and now the present coalition between four parties is in a process. But anyway, because I want to believe that this convention has a future in European Union as a structure within European Union. But because unfortunately Turkey is really not member of European Union. And my question is about the political parties. Is there any support among some political movements? I don't know. Do they have a women's movement, women's party? Thank you.
I am far from an expert in terms of Turkish political parties, but the there are several opposition parties, and the main one, the CHP, has been very vocal in supporting women's rights. It is not a uniform political landscape by any means in Turkey, and there is substantial support among other parties for women's rights. So the hope would be that if Erdogan and his AKP party were to lose in the next election, that it might open up more space for some changes in the government. There are women parliamentarians, and one of the things that ESSEC is doing, which I think is very important, is they do a monthly report and send it to Parliament regarding all the laws and the actions by parliamentarians related to pro or anti-feminist actions that they've taken in the last month.
And I would just add, when it comes to the political field, we heard some great examples from our partners as we were writing our report. For example, our Moldovan women's human rights defender explained how she had lost her connections with politicians over the years. So she decided to go a different avenue, and she reached out to women parliamentary caucuses. And now she's holding these small discussion groups with these caucus groups about the Istanbul Convention. So it's just a matter of finding that those paths to navigate in case the political party's wills are against you. We do, Peggy, we have a couple of questions in the chat. Why don't I bring some of these up? Is there any place where this discussion might occur within the UN, CEDAW or the Human Rights Council?
Well, I think the discussions, and we certainly work with ESSEC and others in terms of Turkey is a member of the UN and has signed on to CEDAW, where there are reviews of Turkey, and we have the opportunity to assist with them and put in comments on periodic reviews and treaty reviews. We certainly will be doing that.
And I would just add that this is a great question because it's very important for us to be at these, to make our presence known at these places. At the UN, some of these anti-gender far-right groups have special consultative status, just like the Advocates for Human Rights has special consultative status. So they are there in the same capacity that we are, making recommendations to the UN and other human rights bodies and trying to influence policy on that level. So it's really important that we get out there and that we continue to push advocacy at that level. I'll end with a silver lining with that question. That is, whenever there's a universal periodic review and the working group comes out with the recommendations, very often we will see the recommendation to ratify the Istanbul Convention. So it's really positive to see that kind of stuff coming out of the UN because they then become tools for our partners in these countries to make change. The next question, I'm going to combine a couple questions. What do you think would be the most helpful for the United States government to do with respect to Turkey? And who can we speak to in the US government about this, whether it's senators, Department of State, or our UN representative?
I think that's a very big question, and I'm not sure I can answer it without doing more work, because again, what we want to do is to be helpful. I know that there are a number of congressmen who are very concerned about human rights and the and erosion of the rule of law in Turkey. And in fact, when Biden came into office, I believe they sent a letter to the Department of State expressing their concern and requesting that the U.S. government keep those concerns top of mind in all of their dealings.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think that that's a great segue. And one thing I want to add too is our report details how the U.S. does have a role, not in terms of the government, but in terms of the U.S. religious right. The U.S. religious right is sending over millions of dollars in dark money to fund these anti-gender groups in other countries to backroll on LGBTI rights, immigrants' rights, and of course, women's rights. So there is a role, you know, whatever that is, to put some pressure and to kind of peel back the layers and expose what these groups, especially the U.S. religious right, is doing. And I think this question also speaks to, you know, the role that people can play with their own governments wherever they live. Another recommendation our report makes is for people in these countries that are really affected by the far right, reach out to their diaspora networks. Their diaspora networks may be living in countries that can do bilateral diplomacy with their own home country, or perhaps there's a very strong Christian or Orthodox presence there that is more supportive of these kinds of human rights that they can also leverage to bring about some pressure within their own home countries. Okay, I'm checking the chat for any more questions. I don't see any more, but I want to give people one more chance in case they had any questions or comments for today's discussion. Okay. I think that that is it. I want to thank you all. And thank you so much, Peggy, for your outstanding work on this issue and your commitment. Peggy was one of the co-authors of the report, as well as the primary author of the Turkey briefing paper. We're so grateful. We're thankful for all of you for joining us today. Again, if you are interested in supporting our work, please feel free to text the word women's with an S to 44321. Thanks again for joining us today and for being a part of the human rights movement.